Good evening, welcome to the June 20th, 2017 Dayton City Council meeting. Tiffany, roll call.
Mayor Maruski.
Here.
Member Volter.
Here.
Member Burns.
Here.
Member Neary.
Here.
Member Baker.
Here.
Member Haas.
Here.
Member Lynn.
Here.
City Administrator Giffen.
Here.
City Attorney Edge.
Here.
All rise for prayer and pledge allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
At this time, anyone in the audience like to address City Council, please stand up, give your name, address, and you can speak.
You are the only one.
I am the only one, good. I did that on purpose.
Go down.
Okay. Penny Hurt, 309 Dayton Avenue, as if you didn't all know that. I'm here on behalf of the Ladies Auxiliary VFW, post 2899. We have a program we instituted last year, and we didn't get a whole lot of feedback on it, but we started it a little bit late in the summer. So we wanted to make you aware of it, and anyone who happens to be watching. Veterans who have seen combat, a lot of times when the fireworks start, they have issues. I know one of our own members, her husband actually had flashbacks to Vietnam, and his PTSD kicked in, and he ended up having a stroke because mortar bombs were being set off around their house up on Upper Dayton Avenue. Not that we think people will stop setting off fireworks, but we have come up with these signs that are available to anyone for people to for veterans to place in their yards, just to make their neighbors aware that, hey, I served our country. Please don't set the fireworks off because it does affect me physically and mentally. So if you know of anyone, that way, okay. If you know of anyone, or Chief, if you happen to come across somebody, or if someone in the fire department, you come across someone who has had an issue, please, they can contact me or the VFW. We're there every Wednesday night and we have these available. I didn't bring the little yard sign stakes with them, but they are just the signs you can stick down in your yard anytime you want. So just pass the word along, and if you know of anyone, please let us know. And they don't have to live here. You can have an uncle who lives in New Jersey. We don't care, because we know that this is a real problem for all of our veterans. And that's all I wanted. Thank you.
Appreciate it. Thank you. Anyone else like to address council? Mayor's reports, ordinance and orders, second readings. 2017-11, the budget for 2017-2018.
City of Dayton, Kentucky, ordinance 2017-11, an ordinance adopting the City of Dayton, Kentucky's annual budget for fiscal year July 1st, 2017 through June 30th, 2018, and estimating revenues and resources and appropriating funds for the city for boards that is authorized by KRS 82.082 and appropriate fees law. This ordinance adopts the budget for fiscal year beginning July 1st, 2017 through June 30th, 2018 for the general fund, municipal wage, park board fund, parks, economic development, and the Sergeant Park fund.
That's the second reading. We need a motion.
I'll make a motion that we approve 2017 number 11.
Motion by Denny.
A second.
Second by Jeff Hawes. Any comments?
Yes, sir. Very first line item on the budget for the property tax revenue is plugged in for a 4% increase, roughly $35,000. I know we don't get the PVA report until August, but I'm hoping that we can have that 4% increase with existing property values increasing and new property added to the rolls. because contrary to some of the rumors going around town, I will not vote for a property tax rate increase. I think we really need to put the brakes on that. Other cities are catching up to us now, which is helping our real estate sales. I really believe that. I discussed this with administration. The pay increases proposed, or possible pay increases, range anywhere from 1% to 11.3%, and that has extra CERS costs. I have some concerns about the disparity in the raise, increases, but that's up to administration to...
That number's not right.
And that's the number on the budget, sir.
It's not right. You don't know the budget you're looking at. It goes from anywhere from 2%, but that's the lowest one, up to 8.2.
I'll go over it here.
But the thing of it is, here's where we are with this budget. The budget is already prepared. We voted on. You got comments on the budget? From state. Can't make them, but I mean, line items, we're not entertaining.
I do have a concern about the funds carried forward amount. 589 is roughly 25% of our reserve. I've never understood how we budget. We have to live within, at least individually, we have to live within our means to underestimate revenues and overestimate costs to the tune of 589 is a dangerous situation to make.
You do live within your budget, but also you got to realize within your budget you have savings, and that's what we got, and that's where that number comes from.
Understood, and by law we're allowed to do that. But I would prefer to see a zero budget, an even budget, which I know would be difficult to maintain, to attain, because we've been doing it this way for years. And then if administration needed more money in some area, to come back to council on it.
One thing, Joe, to clarify, the number really only higher, it actually was actually going to be lower. The only reason it is higher is because we had a budget in the 240,000 of our 20% master riverfront columns. That was really the only discrepancy. It's a one-time thing. If you take that out, the number actually went down from last year. So we're trying to get that trending into a much better direction. We had to throw in the 20% match. That's the reason it's so high. Next year, I don't expect it to be in the room.
I'd like to see it trending down.
Yeah, it is. It
down
is.
To a zero budget.
Anyone else have a comment? Yeah.
We discussed hiring an additional police officer for upcoming year. Is that in this
yes,
budget?
Yes, it is. Anyone else have a comment? Roll call vote.
Member Bacon?
No.
Member Haas?
Aye.
Member Lynn?
Aye.
Member Volter?
Aye.
Member Burns?
Aye.
Member Neary?
No.
The ayes have it. So carried. So ordered. Next on the agenda is 2017-12 amending compensation ordinance.
City of Dayton, Kentucky, ordinance 2017 number 12, an ordinance amending ordinance 2016 number 14, setting forth compensation and number of authorized positions for employees under the Dayton Job Classification System. This ordinance amends the Dayton Job Classification System by amending the compensation for city clerk treasurer, chief of police, police lieutenant, police officer, police clerk, superintendent of public works, seasonal labor, main street manager, and number of authorized positions for a police officer.
This is second reading. Need a motion.
Make a motion to adopt orders number 2017-12.
I'll second.
Motion by Bill, second by Ben. Any comments?
Yes, I have one, Mayor. Under the police officer, it shows an increase of 4 more officers. Is that what I'm saying?
11.
8.
We should have 11 total. We're adding one officer.
But, I mean, let's say you got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This will show a total of 13. Because the police officer went from 4 to 8.
It just shows what's authorized.
Well, yeah, that's what I'm saying. Yeah, this brings them up to a total of 13.
The officer
you're supposed to have.
The officer count was low, so that's really just part of that is a correction.
And then part of that's the school resource. Research that we had to take care of as well. So
So it's actually a little more on the, that's not really counted.
Correct, too.
Okay.
Anyone else have any comments on that?
So these are just the salary ranges, it's not automatically awarding.
No, you have a range on any employee.
Right. I wanted to clarify that.
Thank you. Anyone else? Roll call.
Member Haas?
Aye.
Member Lynn?
Aye.
Member Volter?
Aye.
Member Burns?
Aye.
Member Neary?
Aye.
Member Baker?
Aye.
The ayes have it, so ordered. Next is second reading of 2017-13, text change for zoning in the R1JJ zone.
City of Dayton, Kentucky, ordinance 2017-13. An ordinance amending chapter 154 of the Dayton Code of Ordinances commonly referred to as the City of Dayton zoning ordinance by amending the text of the R1JJ zone. This ordinance amends chapter 154 of the City of Dayton, Kentucky of Code of Ordinance zoning ordinance by adding many uses R1JJ zone if in historic overlay zone located within 100 feet of intersection with 6th Avenue. The permitted uses include apparel shops, artists and craft studios, art studios, bakeries, and bakery goods stores where the products are sold exclusively on the premises, barber shops, hair salons, clothes, stationery, and gift shops, candy, soda fountain, ice cream stores, coffee shops, delicatessens, florist shops, personal trainers, small group fitness, small professional offices such as realtors, private consulting firms, medical, dental, legal, off-street parking lots, parking garages, professional teaching studios on any form of fine arts, photography, music, drama, or dance, and sporting goods. The ordinance also removes art studios as a conditional use in the R1JJ zone.
That's the second reading. I need a motion.
I'd like to make a motion that we accept 2017 number 13.
Motion by Ben.
I'll second that.
Second by Joe. Any comments?
Comment I want to make about this is thanks to the to Mr. Yoder and the Planning and Zoning Commission for well-needed updates. It's opening Dayton back up for businesses. It's good for the city.
Been waiting for this for 3 years, sir.
Anyone else have a comment? Roll call.
Member Lynn?
Aye.
Member Volter?
Aye.
Member Burns?
Aye.
Member Neary?
Aye.
Member Baker?
Aye.
Member Haas?
Aye.
So ordered. Next is the first reading. First reading of 2017-14, amending alcoholic ordinance.
City of Dayton, Kentucky, ordinance 2017-14. An ordinance amending the city's alcohol ordinance to allow for alcohol licensee to have music, dancing, singing, or other forms of entertainment in open-air areas belonging to said licensee. This ordinance amends City of Dayton's alcohol ordinance to allow for sale of alcoholic beverages in open-air areas and have music, dancing, singing, or other forms of entertainment in the same areas.
This is the first reading. Next on the agenda is orders. Order 2017-7R, Homeland Security Green.
City of Dayton, Kentucky, Municipal Order Number 7R. A resolution of the City of Dayton, Kentucky, authorizes the mayor to make application for and upon approval to enter into an agreement with Kentucky Office of Homeland Security to execute any documents which are necessary by Kentucky Office of Homeland Security to facilitate and administer the project and to act as the authorized correspondent for this project. This resolution also establishes procurement policy for any Kentucky Office of Homeland Security approved project for the fiscal year 2017 application cycle.
This is an order. We need a motion.
Make a motion to adopt Municipal Order 7-R.
Motion by Bill, second by Jeff.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? So ordered. One other thing I got on the agenda under my report is that we have a fire board meeting tomorrow night at 6 o'clock at the firehouse. That's about all I got on that. Next is the city administrator's report.
First thing I've got is a special event application for Go Reach Ministries on the Christ Chapel. They're wanting to do their block party on July 15th, 10 a.m. to 2:45 at the Veterans Memorial at 6th and Berry. So I'd like to ask for a motion to accept.
Are they needing any street closure on this one, or is it just in the park? There's in the green space there.
Looks like it's just in the park, in the green space area. no closures are asked for.
I'll make the motion.
Motion by Ben.
Second.
Second by Jeff. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? So ordered.
Last thing, Mayor, just to keep everybody up to speed and those that may not know, obviously, they're going to be doing work to Route 8 in Bellevue starting on July 10th. That's still the date that they're looking to start. I spoke with SD1 this morning. They still haven't finalized the routes, but they have tentatively laid them out. So as soon as those are set in stone, we'll be sure to get those out to you all and to the public.
Thank you, Michael.
So.
All right. Anybody have anything for Michael?
I just want to make a comment to Michael. That is the most absurd thing that SD1 or whoever's doing that job down there, and it terribly disturbs me that they have not thought about the city of Dayton at all. Because I do not know how you're going to get 12 Dayton buses down there. I don't know how you're going to get gas trucks down here. There's our gas stations, or the Nelson Star trucks down there. And if they're going to give us an answer, I think they should give it as an answer before now. We got more reports over the Brent Spence closing than we did to have the Bellevue closing. And what disturbs me, Michael, is the fact that I read an email or read something where some people in the city of Bellevue said, well, we're just going to have block parties and whatever. That's not doing us any good. And then I'm telling you, it is shameful the way they treat the city. Thank you.
Michael, did they do any thought of, like, doing work at night and keeping the avenue open during the day?
Well, the problem is, from what I've been told, is the soil conditions under the road are so bad that they can't even plate it at night. The one thing that SD1 did tell me this morning, that as they work from the north end of Route 8 to the south end of Route 8 up Taylor, that when they get to the southern portion of it, they will be able to hopefully open up one lane of traffic. I don't know how that works. I don't know yet. It's just been relayed to me that the utilities in the area are quite complicated, both overhead and under the ground, and the logistics of it prevented them from plating it and prevented them from doing some things that seem like obvious solutions. But again, I know very little. That's just what was told to me today.
If I could say, I think what we have to remember is the impact. I agree, Bill. I commute through there. It's going to be a pain for me, too. The impact is really going to be on the Bellevue neighborhoods that the detours are going to go through, with parking limitations, with the traffic that they're not used to. Captain Richmond, I'm sure you guys have plans in place for, you know, quick ambulance access, but it's not going to just be shooting right down Route 8 to get to the hospital. It's going to be real complicated. And they'll be going, hopefully, further up Taylor. And it's a storm drain separation, which needs to be done sooner or later. I'm hoping, actually, that SD1 will eventually do this down in Jamestown area on 4th Street to help with some of the flooding issues that we have down there, because they're putting in a bigger pipe down there in Bellevue. It's going to take a lot of the stormwater coming off Dairy Hill. I'm hoping they eventually do it for us, too. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else standing for Mike?
I kind of echo Bill's comments as far as being disrupted and being disturbed. I also know that, you know, there's going to be a lot of folks that will be going now through Dayton, maybe up through Dayton Pike, Fort Thomas. So it's good times ever to people that typically don't get down to this side of the avenue to see our places. So it would be a good time for Dayton to shine to the folks who may not see us normally.
Thank you.
You know,
your
radio
should be. Okay. Next on it is that no one from any department had anything to make any comments on. Bob, you got anything? Any correspondence? Tiffany?
No.
Any petitions, council? No petitions? Okay. Any unfinished business?
A couple of things. I know we've talked a lot about the underpass at Urban Terrace, so I spent some time going up and down there a few times and around. Honestly, if you are going the speed limit, you can see around that bend and you can see oncoming traffic. And I don't know if people are speeding and they're out of their lane, sure, there's going to be a problem. But that's going to be a problem on 6th Avenue. But you really can see around that bend, coming down and up the hill, if you're going 20, 25 mile an hour, there's not a problem there. Now, I will say this, I also did some observations. We have people in this city that do not stop at stop signs. I mean, literally, they go through them going 15 mile an hour. They just kind of look and slow down a little bit and they go right through it. And that's right on 6th Avenue. I just saw a Jeep today run three of them in a row. You know, I was right behind him. So, you know, maybe Chief, we need a little campaign there to nail some of these people that are just trucking on through those stop signs. But, so that was one point I just wanted to make. The other thing is, Mike, I wonder if you could bring us up to speed on the park conversion and the Vine Street Park.
Yep, we've had a lot of activity at the Vine Street Park, ripping some stuff out. I met with a playground designer, and he's put together some models for us that hopefully they'll share in the next couple weeks. Helping with some samples, so he and I are kind of strategizing as far as what we're going to put in, or what could go in, what would fit. And what works best both for young children and middle-aged kids and parents as well. And as far as the park conversion goes, I'm still hopeful that we'll hear something by the end of the month, maybe worst case, beginning of July, but they're asking me quite a few questions, which means that they're constantly looking at our application. They did want us to rerun an advertisement for the environmental assessment, so that was on the paper this Thursday. We've already posted it on the website. It's just a 15-day formality. It's not going to delay it in front of you. So at this point, they're still reviewing it. We're answering their questions. But everything looks like it will come to a conclusion, hopefully, towards the end of this month. Like I said, worst case, first week of July. So.
Great. One thing I would like to pursue, I would like to ask the developer to contribute to the playground. Purchase a playground equipment.
Yeah.
So that's not, I mean, let's just pursue it.
Sure.
Yeah. Okay. Anyone else?
Go ahead. I had asked a few months ago about revisiting the little libraries ordinance that we have, which is really restrictive. Have you had a chance to do that yet, Tom?
Well, that little libraries ordinance is set up because we have zoning laws in the city of Dayton that restrict the different types of buildings and everything else that you have. The only way that we could get around with it with the little libraries was through the process of them actually converting an easement over to the city and then the city giving them a license. That way they could then be exempt from zoning the same way that the city's exempt from zoning. And really that was their only option. Otherwise, I spoke with Cindy Minner about it when we first started this project and the city of Covington, Bellevue, and other places that did the little libraries. And no one has come up with an alternative or that didn't invalidate a lot of zoning to where you essentially wouldn't have everybody with every kind of sign or every kind of outpost building wherever they wanted on the property. So that was really our only option to, control it, but yet allow for it.
So they're sprouting up all over Bellevue. Are Bellevue's zoning ordinances allow this and ours don't?
No, Bellevue zoning ordinance doesn't allow it. Most of the times in Bellevue, I would say, there's a lot of times, I don't want to speak for each building that they've got, but they've got an application process. I'm not completely sure that they're following through to make sure they comply with zoning. I think they're
So there's nothing we could change in our own zoning that wouldn't violate county P&Z to allow these with just a simple application?
Well, no, we could change your own zoning to figure out a way to allow for it. The problem is you can't say it in such a singular term. You'd have to, you'd have to make it into some kind of category so that way it's not some kind of spot zoning. And to do that, you would open the door for so many other types of little outpost buildings and things of that nature that are big birdhouses in the front of people's yards and things like that. We wouldn't be able to stop either. So it's kind of one of those catch-22. We want to open the door a little bit for the little libraries, but you don't want to open the door so far that you let everything on the side unless it makes it really good.
Probably can't do a wink and a nod either.
No, you can't do that either.
Tom, what about a conditional use?
That was, it's the same idea, whether it's as a conditional use or just straight out allowed into the zoning, is you have to open the category wide enough to cover all kinds of ancillary buildings, such as birdhouses, such as little outpost shelters, I forgot what they're called, the ones where you can set benches and patio furniture, there's a lot of different things that would, it would have to encompass to be wide enough not to be, any kind of spot zone.
It's disappointing, because a lot of people, a couple of people have asked about putting one back up.
And we do, someone does apply through the city administration, we do not charge any more than what absolutely takes to do it. It doesn't, actually, I don't charge anything extra out of it, though contractually I could, but I don't charge the city nor the citizen anything for taking the time to fill out the easement and the license form. All we charge them is the cost of possibly the file, if it only closed on us.
Which is what, $50?
No, it's $17 for the easement and $13 for the license.
So $30?
Yeah.
And we had many people apply for this one?
We had, I think, a total of three ever. One of them, there's one at the, that was at the museum, and so that one was city property, they didn't have to worry about any of that, because it's, the city doesn't have to follow the zoning ordinance and city property. The second one was Catherine Hamilton Hicks. That one was subsequently taken down and the restrictions removed. Then I think there was one more, but I can't, that it was a event. Yeah, okay, so it's Councilmember Baker that had his, but those I think were the only ones.
I was thinking, tonight coming here, I went down across Fourth, I seen one down on Fourth, and there's another one I seen somewhere too, doesn't match any description of it. So what I'm saying is, I think some people are just putting these things up, may not know them.
And I think that's a similar problem other cities have heard too.
Actually, I had to remove my.
But you still have the, you didn't come back to get the license.
No, I keep on planning on building a new one.
Yeah. It's still available to you at any time, and you just have to put it back up.
I did put it back up, I had to move it.
The other, sir, I'm sorry. The other piece of unfinished business, and I've mentioned this, I believe, in the May meeting, with vacant home registrations. Jim laughed, but a good example is what happened up on Brooklyn yesterday with the fire up there. We don't know, especially our first responders and our police, don't know that they are vacant houses, okay? They don't know whether to go in and try and say.
We know it's vacant. Please do it. Do you know if it's vacant, Dave?
Yeah, we were actually up there on Friday. We couldn't, the only windows were upstairs on the second floor, which you couldn't reach and climb. It's pretty hard to climb a building without.
How is it going?
And.
How do all of your officers know that it's vacant? My point is.
You could, that was all, it's up, the door, front door was boarded up, the side was boarded up, the basement door. I mean, if a child or a teenager can get in there, I couldn't fit through. I was waiting for Rich to come back this week, telling that we needed to get this boarded up, just that one door in the basement.
It's just, some other cities have like a registry that's available, especially to fire department and police, so that they know exactly, when they get a call and an address, they can act, they can tell that it is a vacant property. And I don't know that we do that. I mean, the last budget report, I think we only had 5 people register as vacant.
Well, I think there was a little confusion there, that there's certain things that Rich had signed for that aren't necessarily vacant, that aren't necessarily matching with the ordinance, I think you referred to.
Right.
So after the meeting, I sat down with Rich and I said, look, we can only get it on the list if it's being reported to the clerk's office, whether it's the police department, the fire department, the code department, or combination of all three. It needs to be that combination that reports that to the office, therefore we can generate that list and spit it back out to police and fire. But that's really our only way of being able to send out these notices that they need to apply or need to register as vacant land, is that we get them from people that are on the streets. It's another way, there's no other way of getting it other than them getting reported into the clerk's office. So that's what's being done.
that we can generate a list that I think you're referring that other cities have.
So I think it would be great if neighbors would, you're asking neighbors or passersby to report that to the city clerk if they know that.
Well, they certainly can. What I was getting at was city personnel.
Right.
Rich, police department, fire department, anytime that they're aware that something may be vacant or abandoned, if they report it to the administration, then we can send out a letter to that property saying if it is vacant or abandoned, required to register. If people want to call that in, that would help too, but I'm not sitting here, you know, demanding that everybody call them in. I'm saying from the city's end, our employees are the first level of defense.
Understood, but nobody knows the neighborhood better than someone.
No, I totally agree. If they want to call it in, by all means.
Right, and I feel so bad for the people across the street there that had suffered from that vacant house for so many years, catches fire and damages their homes too. I think, you know, if we could encourage citizens to report things like that to the city, and whether or not they're already on the list, and then make sure that police and fire both have that list. We don't want to mark them as vacant, don't get, that's not real safe.
But we need to have the list internally so we know who we're sending them out to, otherwise they're going for the clerks to know who starts sending this letter to. It needs to be a combination of, like you said, reporting from citizens, reporting from even Public Works, you know, all the people that are out on the streets on a daily basis, they see something that they think is vacant or abandoned, to give that to the police in the office and the people that start to generate that.
So you're satisfied with the process we have in place is adequate?
Well, at this point, it's really how we, any other way of doing it.
Okay.
It always be better, but resource-wise, I don't think help.
I think when he got Rich on the same page, because I don't think Rich thought that was his job to report it back. So Michael sat down and talked to him and said, hey, here's how it's going to work. It's the only way it can work.
As long as that's been remedied. Because I know in years past, it just seems like some homes had.
Yeah, it was just a coincidence that that line item added up to, because I think the registration is $500.
Right.
When you calculated the 8 homes, it came up to $4,000. It was just actually just my happenstance. But yeah, Rich and I sat down and said, we need to be the ones that send them into to the office, because otherwise they don't know there's something ready to take.
Understood. Thank you. That's all I have, sir.
Great. Anyone else? Any new business?
Can, with the first reading of the ordinance earlier tonight, number 14, hear that number again?
Yes.
That would allow for the restaurants to make a couple extra dollars in the summer months. It's summer right now, and the 4th of July is coming up. Next council meeting will actually be pushed to the 11th. Or no,
18th.
Would it be all right to request a special meeting to read the second reading for number 14 next week so they can maybe make some extra money during the
You can have an earlier meeting in July. You can come in on the 5th of July for a meeting, which would take care of that. Can you go from the 18th to the 5th?
No, we would have enough time to advertise for special
meeting. So does it?
Is there a discrepancy from special meeting council? Is it less than 7?
Yeah, I mean, if they advertise, they just put it out. So,
yeah, well, it has to be 24 hours, right?
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah, I just want to get this answer.
But it's not a Saturday rule, that's special.
Yeah, so I'd like to request that we do that so the folks that are having outdoor dining can make some money during the 4th of July holiday. I think that could help them get through the winter. I'll wait 3 days from now. I'll get a servant man show up. It'd be a really quick meeting, I promise. I'll even ask Joe to say something. Yeah, you'd just be reading one thing.
If you keep killing it, get dead or
get dead. Can we get Joe? Can you hold off your comments to the 18th?
Get a gag order first, and then we'll talk about it.
Give me the wrong date.
We'll have a forum without Joe. We won't even tell Joe.
When do you want to do this?
How about just next Tuesday? Just do it on Tuesday and get it out. Does that work?
27.
We change the time. You can do it to 6 o'clock. You want to do 6 o'clock? 5:30?
I'll be 5:30.
Got a Main Street meeting at 7:00. Get done before that.
Okay, according to the attorney, I can amend this to be an emergency ordinance, and I can have a vote on it tonight and not have a special meeting.
Do we need to make a motion there, or is it?
Yes, yeah.
Yeah, it has to be a motion.
Who makes a motion, would that be a mayor motion or a council motion?
I just made it an emergency, so.
We're gonna have to read it.
Yeah, we're gonna read it, it's an emergency.
You really don't want to see you, Joe.
What's the name?
I didn't want to come back next week either.
I roller skated here today. 24 miles per hour or less.
It's about to have the chief check your license.
Or do you want to comment before the vote?
They need to declare it as an emergency by 3rd.
I declare an emergency and any vote on whether it's an emergency or.
Yeah, it says requirement of second reading may be waived if an emergency is declared, ordinance is voted, and the ordinance is then voted on after the first reading. Emergency may be declared if 2/3 of membership of the legislative body votes to declare the emergency. The emergency must be declared in the ordinance, so. Yeah, you're gonna need a motion.
So first need a motion to a majority to declare an emergency, and then you need a majority for the pass, correct?
But, yeah.
All 2/3.
But you're gonna need 2/3 for the emergency.
I would like to say that.
Not for the actual budget.
Right.
Yeah.
Can I make the motion to declare this emergency? I'd like to make the motion to declare ordinance 2017 number 1 for amending alcohol ordinance an emergency ordinance.
And the, you'll want to, just for the record, so if you want the basis on that, I would recommend to you.
For economic development throughout the city of Dayton.
There you go.
I'll second.
Your motion, second by Joe, motion by Ben, can you read the ordinance? Oh, no, we need a vote for this.
Yeah, roll call.
Roll call vote.
Member Volker.
Yes.
Member Burns.
I want some clarification, this is for the emergency, right?
Yes.
Yes, not the ordinance, no.
Member Burns.
No.
Member Neary.
Aye.
Member Baker.
Aye.
Member Haas.
Aye.
Member Lynn.
Aye.
So ordered. Okay, now we need a reading of the ordinance itself.
You can read it, is that right?
Second, chief.
Good luck. City of Dayton, ordinance 2017 number 14, an ordinance amending the city's alcohol ordinance to allow for an alcohol licensee to have music, dancing, singing, or other forms of entertainment in open air areas belonging to said licensee. This ordinance amends City of Dayton's alcohol ordinance to allow for the sale of alcohol beverages in open air areas and have music, dancing, singing, and other forms of entertainment in the same areas. This is declared an emergency under KRS 83A-060 subsection 7. An emergency is declared on the basis of economic development.
You have a motion?
I'll make the motion that we accept the 2017 number 1 for ordinance amending alcohol.
Motion by Ben.
I'll second.
Second by Jeff Walsh. Any comments?
Yes, sir, I've got a couple comments. First thing, I think we just, you pass that emergency law, I think you went outside. I know what you're saying, it's a law term, I think we just stretched the law a little bit too far. Second thing, I don't have anything about this ordinance. I think you should put some clarification in there about times, because I'm not concerned about a couple of locations, but I am concerned about other locations within the city of Dayton, and I don't think we've looked at it. The other thing I'm concerned about is, once again, we have not given the citizens a chance to get any input. We just passed an emergency meeting tonight about an ordinance, and we're gonna vote on it in July. I just think we've stepped over bounds, but that's my comment.
Anyone else have a comment? Tiffany, roll call, please.
Member Burns?
Aye.
Member Neary?
Aye.
Member Baker?
Aye.
Member Haas?
Aye.
Member Lynn?
Aye.
Member Volker?
Aye.
So ordered. Anyone have any new business?
I have one item, sir.
Go ahead.
I had mentioned this a couple of months ago, and I'm sorry Chief Hatfield left, but especially with the new traffic patterns that we're gonna have going through town here with the detours and everything. Like you said, Bill, people are gonna be going up and down Dayton Pike. I would like to have the city, whether it be through the Main Street Board or social media or whatever, to really, and this is not, I brought this up a couple of months ago, a Drive 25 campaign. There is nowhere in this city that the speed limit is higher than 25 miles an hour. And I've been trying to be cognizant of my speedometer just coming down 6th Street. By the time I get down to Irvin, I've got people on my tail. I'd like to see some kind, I think that would be a good project for us, just to make people more aware that our speed limit is 25 miles an hour.
I think we're out working speech. I mean, the police department's doing everything they can with the staffing that I got. I mean, we're still down 2 officers.
I'm not saying that the police department needs to do it. I'm just making it a public awareness campaign.
I see markings on cars throughout the city.
I have too. Okay, yes.
I'll do it through social media, if that's okay with everybody.
You got a plan.
You got a plan?
Watch what you wish for, because if they start running radar heavy, you know what I mean? They could. They run a lot heavier, so. I can tell you a story about a lady who complained about radar in another city, and she was the first one to get nailed by it. So. Anyone else have any new business? All right. We don't have any executive session. I need a motion to adjourn.
I'll make that motion.
Thank you, Mike.
Joe.
Thank you, Mike. Yeah. All in favor?
Aye.
So ordered. We're adjourned.
I'm over.
Oh, you're in here.